Welcome back. You're still watching Urban Television. We're here with Pastor Nicholas Wafula. He is one of those renowned, can we call him the churchman in the East African region and Uganda. And he's telling us his story about how he walked this journey, his journey of salvation and starting up the Deliverance Church in Uganda when we took actually a break. Pastor, you were telling me there was another side to this story of starting Deliverance Churches in Uganda. What is that other side of the story?
Well, as I said, we started with Deliverance Church in, or we changed the name in 1971. And for those who know the history, even who are reminded 2 or 3 days ago, that is when Idi Amin came into power. And that was a different ball game. It was a difficult time. And of course, like we remembered in Uganda now, Idi Amin was able to forge a story that the Archbishop and two ministers had been involved in a car accident and ending up killing Archbishop Janani Luwum, which was a fake story. So we were part of that scenario from 71. We noticed that there was a government resistance to spiritual things. And with that, we just continued praying until sometime in 77, the government banned all religious groups except four: the Anglican Church, the Roman Catholic Church, the Greek Orthodox, and the Muslims. And all the others were banned. And of course, other religious groups took cover under other religious existing groups. But with us, because in 1976, we started house groups of our churches, meeting in houses and also coming in the main hall, main service every Sunday. It was a very difficult time, but I think I heard God saying, the temple meetings are over, but house group meetings continue. So we decided to send a message across all our churches to make sure that we continue underground. And so for 2 years, we operated as an underground church. And I happened to be the leader of at that time. Because before that, Idi Amin started looking for our pastor then, Pastor Stephen Mungoma, who was a lecturer at Makerere University, because we had published a newspaper saying, we don't fight against flesh and blood, but prosperity is in high places. And Amin thought fighting somebody in high place was the one. So they looked for him. And I must say, fortunately, because I come from Busia, I was able to get my brother Stephen Mungoma safely across the border into Kenya. And when I came back, I remember it was 31st March 1977, the brothers, the lay sisters and of Deliverance Church asked me to lead. So when the ban came later on in July, that's the very year, I had to take responsibility, and I was able to lead the underground church for the two years. Now, just to give an example how we operated in Kampala. In Kampala, we had 4 centers, and we nicknamed them. We gave them code names. We had one in Kamwocha. We called that the Nile, because it was near Kira Road. Yeah, we called it the Nile. And just a little bit of background, we were meeting in a house of one of the widows of the husband of whom Idi Amin had had firing squad. You know, we used to have firing, they had a firing squad. And he was a big man, I think almost PS, Minister of Education, called Y.Y. Okot. So we used to meet in the widow's house.
He was killed.
The husband was killed by firing squad at the clock tower. But thank God the wife is still there even today. And I thank God that even the children, one of the children is one of the elders in our church, and we praise the Lord for that. That was one center. The other center was in the center. We called it the center. Now, there were flats near Cross the King, and one of us was staying in that flat. So we used it also as underground church. The other one was below Namirembe Hill. And it was a workshop which belonged to two of us. I can mention their name. It was being run by Pastor Danny Naya and Pastor Lebani Jumba before they became pastors. So we used also to pray in that underground church, and we called it the Valley. Then there was one on the hill, Tank Hill. Now that was in the house of now Dr. Ben Oluka. At that time, he was under secretary in the office of the president, Amin, assigned to watch over religious leaders. And here we had a house group, underground church in his own house. So those were four centers in which we operated. But the scenario just went across. We had Entebbe, we had Jinja, we had Gulu, and other places.
That was quite a wide network you had there. But let's start from you sneaking Pastor, the pastor, the one from
okay,
Makerere University.
Taking him to the
Kenya.
Border.
Weren't you scared for your life at that point because the political environment was not so good? So.
Well,
why take that very huge risk?
It was not just a risk. As Christians, the Bible is very clear. The just shall live by faith. So it was all a faith venture. We had to do something to rescue our brother because we knew if they got hold of him here, his head would be chopped off. As you know, even with him, he didn't mind. One day, I think he was in a cabinet meeting and was talking about foreign affairs minister. And 2 weeks later, Honorable Ondoga was floating on River Nile. So there were no jokes. They don't just play. So jokes. I had to risk for the sake of my brother.
But you're also putting your life at risk because
you just said there were no jokes at the time. Yeah, yeah.
You're taking him across, he's safe. And then you're coming back, you're equally not safe.
And
so how do you keep yourself safe?
Yeah, it is walking by faith. One other incident I didn't tell you, when the day they banned those churches, okay, all the other religious groups, I was deep in the village in the Palisa. Palisa then, now it is Bodaka, okay, where I had gone for the burial of my wife's father when the ban took place. And of course, a lot of roadblocks came up. I had to be escorted secretly from Bale up to Kampala before I continued to Gayaza. We were in the same taxi, but this brother couldn't identify himself with me, you know. So it was a risk. It was a faith venture, I call it. But God saw us through. Amin went running. We are here still talking in Uganda.
Were they looking for you by the time they had?
No, they didn't.
What was happening?
We thought they were looking for the leaders of the religious groups which had been banned. That was our mentality. That's why I had to have a private escort with me. When we reached Kampala, I told him, now I can get myself to Gayaza, you go back to Mbale.
Okay. You had to pay him to do that? Or
he was a member of the church. He was a member of the church.
Okay. Mm. So he was also making a sacrifice for you?
Yeah, he made a sacrifice, a risky one. And the reason for they did that, he would just watch and see which road broke. I was taken off at. Then he would go back to report that he was taken off at Ginger Road Block or whichever roadblock. That was what was in our mind.
What if you were to be taken at the roadblock?
Well,
what would have happened at that time?
I don't know. God would have still have taken over. Yeah, but he didn't allow me to be taken off at any roadblock.
Right, because I'm just imagining, because you're with him, then he was to report.
Mm.
If you were to be taken away, he would say he was taken away from this roadblock. So is that where the search starts for you? What would have happened?
I'm sure if he went back and reported, they would know how to handle. Mm. The one thing I would not do is to reveal that he is part of me.
Oh.
Even when I'm being taken away, I wouldn't have done that.
Oh. Okay, interesting. And you mentioned how you had four cells in Kampala.
Yes.
One belonged to somebody who actually was in government.
No,
we
were using his house.
Yes.
It didn't belong to him. He was a member of the church and we were using
his house.
House, yes.
As a cell,
yes.
For your members.
Mm.
So how do you keep yourself safe, all of you? Because you know that time there was a ban. Anything can happen to any of you. Anybody can go and report. This is a person who was in government. So how did you maneuver? How did you make sure you're not caught in your underground movement with the church?
Well, the answer to that, yeah, I can say is God. I don't know how he did it. And we are never in any way harassed or found out in Kampala. But I can give you two incidents. In Entebbe, they were found having a house group. And all of them were taken to the police station. There were 11 of them. Then one of us who was not in the meeting at that time was at work, and he was a converted Muslim. He was a Muslim before and he had become a Christian. When he came and had his friends were arrested, he wanted to go, like when your friends are in prison, you want to go and see them. So he went, and now for him, it was a time to witness. He started preaching to the policeman on duty, telling him how Muhammad couldn't help him and how he was changed and Jesus Christ has done a lot of things in his life.
Mm.
And they just got hold of him and pushed him in to join the others. He became number 12. Now, they did all the investigations and that they could, and they didn't find anything connecting them. So they were all released and set free. So that was an incident in Entebbe. Now, the one in Laivi, near Gulu, I had used to visit different parts, and then the house groups would gather. And the one in Laivi was just Laivi Secondary School before Gulu. We met in an old woman's house. She was a widow. And there were too many. And I didn't know what to do. So eventually, I decided that we'll go to Andy Tree in the open, when you're supposed to be in hiding. But God helped us. We were under that tree from morning up to evening. And 15 minutes after everybody had gone away, at about 6:15, the CID from Guru Barracks arrived in the home. And they just missed us by 15 minutes. Now, to me, that was a miracle. So that's how God protected us in different situations. I just give those as two examples.
Interesting. That means somebody had reported that.
Yeah, somebody had reported that there are some people meeting outside somewhere. Oh, but the timing was quite right for us and the wrong for them.
A miracle indeed. So we'll take another break. We shall come back with more of this conversation with Pastor Wafula.